Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have apologies this morning from Karen Adam, and Ben McPherson is attending as Karen's substitute. Welcome. Our first agenda item, therefore, is to invite Ben McPherson to declare any relevant interests.
I just refer members to my register of interests, including that I'm on the role of Scottish solicitors.
Thank you. Our next item on the agenda is to agree to take agenda item 4, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Agenda item 3 is to hear further evidence to our inquiry into the asylum seekers in Scotland. And we will hear this morning from John Taylor, Chief Operating Officer at Mears Housing Management, who is with us in person this morning. Good morning, John. And Caroline O'Connor, who is the Chief Executive Officer of Migrant Help, who is joining us virtually this morning. Welcome, Caroline. I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I will invite each of our witnesses to make short opening remarks. And I would like to start with John Taylor, please.
Thank you very much. Good morning, and thank you very much for inviting us to give evidence today. I'd just like to start by explaining a wee bit about Mears Group. Mears Group is a housing company. We employ more than 1,300 people across Scotland. Our care team runs combined care at home and housing support services for adults with disabilities or mental health needs. Our facilities management team support 16 schools across Inverness and West Lothian, 2 housing associations in Glasgow, and healthcare settings in St Andrews Community Hospital NHS. In the last year, we completed nearly 120,000 repairs and maintenance to council homes in North Lanarkshire, employing 480 people, including the direct provision of 195 craft apprentices. In Scotland, Mears Group operates through its Responsible Business Charter, which outlines a series of pledges to its staff, partners, contractors and service users. Mears is committed to pay all staff and regular contracted workers the Scottish Real Living Wage. We have signed the Scottish Business Pledge. Our new independent customer scrutiny board was set up to strengthen tenant rights for our customers. The board is chaired independently and is made up of residents and tenants from across our services, including asylum seekers. For each Mears employee, we deliver on average £2,500 per employee of social value per annum. This is decided by using a recognised model to calculate the value of well-being. We will encourage the involvement of the local supply chain in our projects by seeking to work collaboratively across Scotland's housing management sector. We will publicise the revenue and profit that we make each year as a group. Overall, we do not expect to achieve a profit margin from our public sector work of more than 5% to ensure value for money. In January 2019, Mears has awarded the asylum contracts for three contract regions, Scotland, Northern Ireland, North East Yorkshire and Humber. Following a transition period, we became the provider in September 2019. Mears is an experienced provider of housing across the UK, providing much needed homes for homeless households through our English-based housing association, as well as for the Ministry of Defence and Ministry of Justice. We've approached this contract committed to treating all our service users with dignity and respect. It is important to say that ours is a specific role around asylum and support while in our accommodation. We have no role in the processing of claims and other services such as the provision of healthcare, education. We signpost to the relevant appropriate agencies rather than Mears provide direct. Our role is operational policy, is set by the UK Home Office, and we refer policy questions to them. I hope that the committee will understand this is an important distinction between what we can do and what we can affect. Operationally, Mears has supported many, many thousands of people in asylum accommodation in Scotland, and feedback in general has been very positive from the service users directly about the way our staff treat them and about the quality of our housing provision. Where there are any issues, we do our best to support our service users and resolve them through our welfare teams and our safeguarding teams. We're committed to ensuring the asylum accommodation is safe, habitable and fit for purpose, and will meet the contractual and regulatory standards. Mears understands the importance of supporting each person whilst living its accommodation and to ensure that as a company, it works with the communities in which we work. We work very closely in partnership with local statutory agencies, including the NHS, councils, particularly Glasgow City Council, and the police. And we have excellent partnerships in the community with local organisations, NGOs, charities and support groups, sport clubs, faith groups and many more. If the committee would like to see more of what we do, I can provide detail of many projects we support and fund and organise. Asylum accommodation and support provision is complex and at the moment very controversial, and there are many challenges, but we are proud of our dedicated staff and the work they do every day across Scotland. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Caroline?
Thank you, Convener and committee members, for the opportunity to share our experience with you. I am Caroline O'Connor, the Chief Executive at Migrant Help. We are a UK-wide charity that provides support to victims of displacement and exploitation, and 2023 marks our charity's 60th year. Migrant Help is one of two providers offering support to survivors of trafficking in Scotland, the other being Tara, who gave evidence at an earlier session. Tara supports female victims of commercial sexual exploitation, and Migrant Help supports all other adult survivors in Scotland. The work is funded through the Scottish Government's Victim-Centred Approach Fund, and we deliver similar services for survivors in Northern Ireland and parts of England. Migrant Help also provides support to asylum seekers across the UK through the Home Office's Advice, Issue Reporting and Eligibility Contract, known as AIR, for which we're in the fourth year of delivery. We provide face-to-face and remote services in Scotland with a team of advisors based in Glasgow, supported by outreach and community liaison staff, as well as our 24/7 call centre. In other parts of the UK, we also deliver services under the UK Resettlement Scheme. We support Afghan and Ukrainian refugees in hotels. We're supporting Hong Kong National Employability Scheme and the EU Settlement Scheme. I look forward to providing you with more information about our work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Caroline. Thank you for those opening statements. And we will just go straight to questions. I intend to allow around 75 minutes for this session. I will grant some flexibility. We do have areas to explore, so I would welcome succinct questions and answers as far as possible. Thank you. And I'd like to start with my colleague, Paul.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and good morning to Caroline and John. I wonder if I can begin. Committee recognises that asylum and immigration are reserved matters, but we, I think, are particularly interested in the devolved areas, particularly looking at the Scottish Government's work to address many of the issues which we've already heard this morning and throughout our evidence. So I suppose if I can just perhaps ask you to share with us what involvement you have had with the Scottish Government strategies, particularly the New Scots strategy and the Ending Destitution strategy.
We work and we have worked since mobilising the contracts back in 2019 very closely with the Scottish Government, COSLA, and the Glasgow City Council Partnership Board. So the Scottish Government, we probably meet once a month and more regularly during the COVID periods to make sure that they're fully informed of the accommodation contracts, the issues that we're facing, particularly during the COVID period, the pressure on numbers, and that Scotland wasn't a routing area for periods of that COVID time. So we've had direct conversations. We are at the moment looking to meet with the relevant ministers to discuss a number of issues that are facing the asylum contracts in the next year, namely around wide dispersal and the impact on local authorities across Scotland, particularly around health, education, social services, and how that can be supported, how that can be managed whilst not conflicting with other projects such as the Ukrainian programme, Afghan Syrians, unaccompanied children, all of which are looking for accommodation. We're very concerned that we end up chasing the same properties. And clearly, and the other issue we want to discuss more in more detail with the Scottish Minister is around homelessness. We are going to see a lot more people now having decisions being made in the system, having decisions being stopped during COVID. And therefore, with a number of positive decisions, there's going to be real pressure on homelessness and how we can work together to make sure there's a balance and we don't create another problem as people come out of the asylum system. So we've always worked closely with the Scottish Government. I think, hopefully, we'll work ever closer because I think the next couple of years could be very challenging on a number of levels. Wide dispersal does change the landscape significantly.
Caroline,
do you have anything to add?
Yes, thank you. Migrant Help is closely involved in delivering towards the five principles of the New Scots approach, supporting integration from day one and building on the rights-based approach through initial induction information and through the 24/7 helpline. We provide induction on arrival, including translated induction booklets, followed by verbal induction briefings with interpreters. We involve asylum seekers and victims of modern slavery through our lived experience advisory panels to develop and to improve our services. We have a community liaison coordinator, and we have regional managers for both services, and both of our head of regional services and our head of business support services have been working and living in Scotland for many years. We collaborate with other charities and with the COSLO, and we're part of working groups with both. We've got those other charities who have given evidence in this session, Red Cross, Scottish Refugee Council and Refugee, we work very closely with, and Tara, we work with on behalf of the Scottish Government.
Thank you, convener. John, you mentioned the challenges, I think, that exist currently in terms of the interaction with local authorities, particularly around housing supply. Wider dispersal, in your view, will exacerbate those issues. In your view, is the challenge with local authorities in terms of what's available, or is it about how Mears chooses to interact with that? I mean, there have been a number of high-profile cases that I think we would all recognise that have been particularly concerning. And is your view that that's about the interaction with local authorities? Is that where the problem is?
No, not at all. I think the interaction with local authorities in Scotland has been incredibly positive. Through COSLA, we've been discussing wider dispersal since the autumn, and we've taken time to make sure there's an agreement about how wider dispersal can be managed in a planned way, strategic way, but also trying to demonstrate some fairness in the system, that we don't have more subsidies in one area than others. So all 32 councils have looked to participate, and we're trying to work through the acquisition process to make sure that we have that fair dispersal across Scotland. I'd say that every council has entered into those conversations with a good deal of openness and willingness to participate and understand the system. Glasgow have been particularly strong in explaining how well we work with Glasgow and how dispersal works and the support needs in dispersed accommodation. So I don't think that's the case. I think we have some very good relationships with the local authorities, and COSLA are very good at managing that in a formal governance structure. I think the issue for us is more around supply, and there's a limited supply of accommodation in the private housing market. And as I said, there's a lot of programmes that are all looking to access that private market, whether it's homelessness. So Glasgow has a particular challenge around homelessness at the moment, and they will take the brunt, if you like, of the challenge of housing people that get the right to remain in Scotland. And they're looking then to go through the Scottish and the Glasgow Homelessness Service. So it's about how the impact on this programme, the number of properties we need to get people into their own homes, where do we procure them, where will it be safe, where can we make sure we get the right services to people, that they're not isolated, that we deal with community cohesion issues, that our service users can access legal services, they can access local community and faith groups. That is a huge operation to make sure that as we go into new areas, they're supported, and that our acquisition of property doesn't then conflict with the programme to find accommodation for Ukrainians, the Afghans, or indeed local homelessness services. So there's a quite a complex network of issues, but I would say that our conversations with the Scottish councils have been incredibly positive and very welcoming.
I wonder, just on the point about local authorities, before I move on to a human rights approach, I wonder, does Caroline, in terms of your interaction with local authorities, where do you see the gaps currently, or the challenges, I think, in terms of wider support provision?
The wide dispersal area and the short time frame in which it is needed to stand up properties. So it's very difficult to find accommodation for asylum seekers very quickly. Once it's identified, there's a need to place people there. So I think the lead time to bring in support is difficult. And there's also a huge risk, and we're seeing this around the country, that support for asylum seekers is very focused in specific regions where there's historically been a great deal of dispersal. And opening up new regions means there's a limited amount of support functions in those regions, and there's not enough time for charities to stand up that support, nor enough funding to reach 400 hotels across the UK. And that's where a real risk is. I accept the problem that we need to find accommodation for people, but we're following it up by support later than would be ideal.
Thank you, Caroline. I wonder then, you know, we've had a conversation there about resource, and very often these decisions become very resource-driven because of the pressures, I think, that are on local authorities and other agencies. The evidence we've heard thus far in committee from people like the Children's Commissioner is that actually we need to, I think, refocus this and look with a human rights lens, because, you know, there are serious concerns, I think, about the dignity. John, you spoke about dignity and respect in your opening statement, and I think the lack of dignity and respect very often for many people who are seeking this support. I referenced in a previous question, you know, those high-profile cases of people being inadequately housed or housed in very inappropriate settings, challenges, I think, in terms of people being left destitute. So I wonder if you would reflect, do you think that you do take a human rights approach in Mears, for example, and what more do you think you could do within your contracts to actually achieve that dignity and respect that you spoke about?
I think we do. With the independent surveys of residents, the feedback is very positive in terms of how they feel they're treated by our staff and the property we provide to them. There is a difficulty in getting enough property, so we aren't happy that we have to house people in hotels. I think that's the single biggest challenge to us, that when we started this contract, no one was living in hotels. At the beginning of the COVID period, we didn't operate hotels. Because of COVID and the cessation of decisions, the system became locked, if you like, and that's where the use of hotels became a main issue. So making a hotel a good place to live is very challenging. Our staff are on site 5 days a week. We have a 7 days a week service. We have some welfare support officers. We work very closely with the asylum health bridging team from the NHS to make sure the support's on site. But no one would say that a hotel is where people would ideally be housed for any period of time. So I'd say that's the biggest single challenge. In our dispersed accommodation, I would say that the accommodation, we have clear contractual standards and they are constantly checked by the Home Office. They have compliance teams that visit. We are very transparent about the service we provide, the number of repairs we do, and the visits we do to every property to try and make sure the properties are well maintained and looked after, and that people are supported whilst they're in the system in the dispersed accommodation. And obviously, as we look to wide dispersal, as Caroline indicated, we need to make sure that if we take properties on in Perth and Aberdeen, Dundee, that we are able to provide that service to support them whilst they're in the dispersed accommodation waiting for the decision on their asylum application. And the quicker those decisions are made, the better. So I would say, you know, we are transparent. We welcome people to come and see our properties. We're not, you know, we're quite clear in the dispersed accommodation. Our staff behave and I think produce a good quality service where we look to put the interests of the service user at the heart of what we do. The hotels, I say, are a very challenging place to be living. If you're living in a hotel for 3 weeks, I think that's one thing. If you're living there for months, then it becomes a very difficult place to be. We try and make sure families aren't in hotels for long periods of time because it's clearly not a right place for a child to be living. So we do try and make sure that we manage that as best we can. And until we can get that wide dispersal moving and get the large volume of accommodation that's needed to make sure that we can end the use of hotels. It's not in anyone's interest to maintain hotels for any longer than necessary.
And if I can, Convener, are you cognizant of the criticism, quite frankly, of people like the Children's Commissioner on some of the circumstances in which particularly pregnant women have found themselves, issues around how hotels are managed and supported by mayors, and how do you then react to that criticism and take it on board and make changes? Because I think much of the evidence we have heard thus far has suggested that doesn't always happen, or there's a real feeling that it doesn't always happen. So
it's a very emotional area, this, and I appreciate everyone has their views. We have talked to the Children's Commission on multiple occasions. I think one of the issues he was probably referring to was we established a mother and baby building in Glasgow. That's a use of accommodation that's been used elsewhere in the UK. We have a number of mother and baby buildings in the North East Yorkshire Humber area. They have worked very effectively in terms of supporting single mothers, in terms of them getting that support. We found a building which we agreed with Glasgow City Council was appropriate and would potentially offer that support. So we established it. It was during the COVID period, and the Children's Commissioner was concerned at the that building didn't meet the needs of mothers and babies the way it should do. So we took on that board and we ended its use and used that building for something different. So I think we do listen, we do learn, we do things for the best of reasons. That type of unit was very successful elsewhere. It wasn't in this circumstance, so we've ended its use. The feedback we get from the Children's Commissioner and any support group, I talk regularly to the Scottish Refugee Council, feeds into our service, and we're constantly looking to improve our service and change it based on feedback. And that's empirical, objective feedback. We'll always look at what we can do to improve. And I think it is an area with strong opinions, and we try and work on evidence base. And we've invited many people to come to see our properties and come to the hotels to see what they're like, see what we can do differently. So we, with the hotels, we talk to the service users about menus. We change the menus regularly. We try and make sure that the dietary requirements are taken into account and that people's views are taken into account. So nothing is perfect, but we do listen, we do and evolve our services, and we do change our services to try and meet the pressures and the criticisms that may get made. So I genuinely think our staff are committed to that. Certainly everything I've seen in terms of my time in visiting the buildings, visiting properties and talking with staff and reviewing our services and the feedback we get, we indicate that is at the heart of what we do.
Can I bring Caroline in, please, just now?
Thank you. I wanted to add, we are concerned about mother and baby units because it's had limited testing and evidence around it. And we believe more needs to be done to understand and evidence the impact on mothers and babies. So we're funding a pilot programme at a cost of £165,000 with a happy baby community in London, where there are some mother and baby units to explore exactly this. And the outputs will be included in the production of a report from the Institute of Health Visitors on improving maternal mental health. And we're also working with a steering group, including both them and the Royal College of Midwives, and the pilot started earlier this year. So we're working to get evidence around what best practice is to support mothers and babies. Thank you.
Okay, all right.
And I've just one more briefly, convener, thank you. Obviously, we have been really cognizant of the illegal migration bill in this committee and looking at its impact. And I wonder maybe if, Caroline, I can come to you in terms of, it has been suggested that a broader humanitarian strategy that might pull lots of different Scottish Government strategies together might be a better way to respond to that. Would you have a view?
I do have a view, and I agree it would be welcome, but I am very concerned around the urgency of the illegal migration bill as it proceeds rapidly. I think we're best relying on the existing strategies, which are excellent in Scotland, that are in place, and do what we can to push towards those strategies rather than try and develop a new one.
Okay. Very grateful, convener.
Thank you. Thanks very much. We were on the theme of housing, so I think it's an appropriate time to bring in the vice convener, Maggie Chapman, please.
Thank you very much, Kirkab, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for the information you've provided so far. Yes, I want to drill down in a little more detail into the use of hotels, and if I can come to you, John, first on this. Can you tell us how does MIAS go around selecting hotels? Obviously, we know, you know, we're looking at more and more cities, more and more places around Scotland. How would you go around looking and selecting hotels for use? What do you take into account?
Yeah, we it has evolved over 2 or 3 years in which hotels have been used. We have a lot more hotels in Northern Ireland and North East Yorkshire Humber than we do Scotland. We look for town centre settings so that they're not remote, so people can leave the hotel and be part of the community, because clearly being isolated is a massive issue. we try and make sure that there's enough facilities on site, that there is adequate dining facilities and other areas where we can operate projects like English lessons, play sessions for children, etc., if children are at the hotel, and other sports activities for the residents to make sure they can be active, and that there's offices for health to visit the site as well. So we try and make sure that hotels have those sort of basic facilities. We look for ensuite rooms so people have some privacy. And we'd look to make sure that most hotels are at least 30 rooms, because therefore you do create communities where people can make friendship groups and not feel too isolated in their own lives, because they are likely to be in the hotel for a number of months. We are constrained by the market as how many hotels are actually available and want to be involved in this type of process. And there are, as I said earlier, there's a lot of competition for the hotels. The Ukrainian programme has used a lot of hotels as well. And around some cities, some of the homelessness teams do as well. So we need to work on the art of the possible, what's available. We need to make sure that the cost is value for money, but that we have a clear standard for the size of rooms, the facilities and the quality of the hotel to make sure that it is a decent place to stay, albeit not where it's ideal. So it is very much led by the market, then by our quality standards and location. It's not always possible to get everything right on that, unfortunately, just because of the limited supply.
Yeah, if I can just explore that a little bit further. In terms of the operation of the hotels, you talked earlier about, you know, food and obviously the need for culturally sensitive food and that kind of thing. What direct operational involvement do you have in the running and maintenance of the hotels once asylum seekers are being accommodated there?
We're responsible for that hotel, so we have direct involvement. So the hotel operator will provide the cleaning staff, the laundry, reception staff, 24 hours a day, so someone's always on site. We have a welfare officer on site.
Sorry to interrupt you there. So the hotel staff that are there, cleaning, catering, and those kinds of staff, they won't necessarily have trauma training or they won't necessarily have expertise in dealing with people who have been through traumatic situations. Is that correct?
We provide training for the staff on site, and our welfare officer is on site as well. So we have someone from MERS who's fully trained on site as a welfare officer, and we work with the hotels to make sure their staff are supported. The same goes for the security staff. We'll have a security guard on site. That's as much to maintain order in the hotel, in terms of sometimes people try and get into the hotel. Unfortunately, we do have protesters, so the security guards aren't there because of any issues necessarily in the hotel. It's more to make sure people feel safe on site, and they are trained and suitably qualified as well. So people on site are trained and supported by us. We are responsible for their behaviours. If there's any behaviours from hotel staff that falls below the standards we set, then we can deal with that with the hotel operator to make sure that staff treat residents in the way you would expect, with the dignity and respect you would come to expect of any operation. We make sure the rooms and the hotel is cleaned daily, and that people have the services you'd want. The food is very important, and we'll often work very closely with caterers in the hotel to make sure that, as we say, the menus are varied, they change, and they do adapt to the residents' personal requirements, because each hotel will have a different cohort of people. Therefore, we want to make sure the food meets what they would expect from where they come from. So that's really important to us. So yes, we do have a lot of input, and we do have ultimate responsibility for what happens in the hotel.
Can I just ask, you mentioned welfare officers and security staff that you have, that are MERS staff. And you talked about they are trained. What, can you tell me what training they do have, you know, in terms of engaging and dealing with potentially traumatized people, families, those kinds of complex issues that you've already spoken about. What training do the staff who are on site all the time actually get?
Welfare officers go through a series of training sessions around dealing with trauma, dealing with vulnerabilities. What I can do is email you a schedule of what every welfare officer will have trained through, because I'll probably miss out a few of the courses if I try and do it from memory. But they are fully trained. The security guards are employed by through security companies who are accredited and fully trained, and we make sure they also go through some of our training sessions as well, so they understand that why they're in that hotel. They understand cultural differences, cultural sensitivities. So they are guards that aren't necessarily understand why they're in that hotel, why the hotel operates, and who's living there. And they go through that training with us as well. But they have the accreditations for security guard.
Okay. And in terms of the hotels, and you talked about the locations. You know, you look for town centres, you look for connections to other facilities. What engagement do you have with the local community, either prior to hotel selection or once a hotel has been identified? What engagement do you have with neighbouring residents, with the third sector, who will obviously be keen to provide some support that me as migrant help don't support? You know, we've heard about other third sector organisations coming in. How do you do that prior to asylum seekers actually being moved in to the hotel?
My colleague Pam is going to sort of drill down into the third sector. So, John, feel free to answer the question if you can leave the third sector bit, because we've got a line of questioning on that. Okay. Thank you.
Lovely, thank you. When we put forward a hotel as being potentially available, so the Home Office eventually ultimately responsible for deciding whether the hotel is booked and comes into occupation. With the lead up to that, there is substantial consultation with the local authority around services, education, if there's any children going to be at the hotel, which is not often the case, health services, the police. So there's a lot of conversations going on with all those statutory agencies, as well as the third sector, which, as you say, we'll come on to. And when we set the hotel up, the police will often come into the hotel and they will help talk to the residents about community safety and understanding of cultural differences. We will work very closely with the local authority. So in Perth and Kinross, for example, we have weekly meetings with the council to discuss how we support the hotel users and how we provide extra services to make sure that they are well and their well-being is protected. So I would say that the engagement we have from Scottish councils is very, very positive when compared with other areas of the UK, I'd say, and that the councils look to make sure we have those networks with police, with the NHS, with support groups, so that we can then create projects and activities that keep people busy, fit and healthy as possible. So I would say that the engagement, as I say, is as positive as anywhere and is really welcomed in the way the local authorities approach that with us.
Okay, just a couple more questions, and then I've got a couple for Caroline. John, just with wider, I suppose, engagement with local residents. If there are local residents who want to come in and, you know, speak to and welcome the asylum seekers who are accommodated in hotels, how do the welfare officers and security personnel you have on site, how do they manage that?
We have to be very careful, because anyone coming onto site, we have to know why they come onto site and their reasons. Certainly down in North East Yorkshire Humber, some people have wanted to come onto site, and when we've discovered that they have other motives, we do have a lot of far-right protesters, so we have to be very careful about who's allowed in. So we do ask that people come to us through voluntary organisations where we can agree access and make sure that people are safe and there's no poor behaviours, which is more than possible. So the security and safety of the residents has got to be first and foremost. If there are community resident groups who want to engage with us, then we absolutely do. But we need to make sure it's done in a supportive and positive way. Access the hotel is safe.
And in Scotland, what's the average length of time for people to stay in hotels? We've heard what you've said already about availability of dispersal accommodation and hotels being institutionalised more and more, which is problematic. But what is the average length of stay in hotels?
It's really hard to give an average, because up until very recently, we only had a small number of hotels in Glasgow. It's only in the last sort of 9 months when we've got to sort of 11 or 12 hotels. So coming up with an average is difficult. There are some people that have been in a hotel in Glasgow for more than a year, some approaching 2 years, and that's due to how long they're in the system. So we only move people out of the hotel when the Home Office asks us to. So that person's reached the point where they can go from Section 98 to Section 95, and we can move them to dispersed accommodation. So the pace at which we move people out is dictated by the Home Office. If we feel that someone needs to be prioritised, then we will petition through Migrant Help, asking that they are moved sooner because it's for their well-being. Some people move on within weeks or months. It's to do with their priority and where they are in the system. So there is no rule of thumb other than we'd all say that people are living in hotels far too long, and the quicker we can get dispersed accommodation in hotels, the better.
Okay, and just one...
Just been indicated by Rachel that she'd just like to follow this up before you move on to Caroline. Rachel?
Okay. Yes, thank you very much, Convener. I'd just like to ask why there are challenges to moving to dispersed accommodation, other than the fact that you've stated that some of the individuals could become institutionalised and within the hotel accommodation.
It's availability of accommodation. There was agreement to wider dispersal across Scotland out of Glasgow last year, and we worked very closely with COSLA, the 32 councils, and the Scottish Government to agree what wider dispersal should look like. So rather than just start and without good consultation, we've spent a number of months agreeing a plan with COSLA and the local authorities for what wider dispersal should look like. So it's only the last couple of months that we've been trying to acquire properties on the scale needed to make sure people can move out, so people aren't staying there too long. So there is a timing issue in terms of getting the dispersed accommodation across the country so that we get the volume that we can move people out. The decision on the rate of how people move out and how they're prioritised, that does rest with the Home Office, and Caroline is part of that process. I'm sure she can have some insight into how that, what they call ITP process, works. But at the moment for us it is a dearth of property. We haven't been able to, we're not acquiring any more properties in Glasgow. We have over 5,000 service users in Glasgow, and that's far too many for one city. So we are trying to procure right across Greater Glasgow, the Central Belt, up the East Coast, Dundee and Aberdeen, the Lothians, and eventually all 32 councils. And that hopefully will mean that we can supply, can catch up with the demand, and we can end the use of hotels, and people won't stay in a hotel for the periods they are at the moment.
Okay. Maggie?
Follow up on that. Are asylum seekers comfortable in the process of moving?
To have lost you there, Rachel. Do you just want to repeat your last sentence, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. I was just wondering, are asylum seekers comfortable if they are being moved from a city to a rural area, if that's the only option that they have?
I wouldn't say comfortable. I think it's very challenging. So people who go into hotels generally newly arrived in the country, so often they will be coming from the south of England up to Scotland, or probably the most common of people that have declared asylum in Scotland, and therefore we will place them where we have a hotel room. I think it's fair to say that people generally would like to be in Glasgow because they know there's lots of networks in Glasgow. We don't have hotels in rural settings. We have them in smaller towns, Perth, Aberdeen, Dundee, Erskine in Renfrewshire. So there's a number of different hotel settings that are generally in urban settings. People, I think, would prefer to be in Glasgow, but clearly we've made that commitment that we'll have no more hotels in Glasgow due to just overwhelming demand on that accommodation in Glasgow. So, yes, I don't think comfortable. I don't think anyone's comfortable moving to a hotel. I think only if it's over a number of weeks. We just try and make sure that they're well informed of what's happening. But generally, people going to hotels, I say, have newly arrived in the country and will come through that system, and we will place them as best we can.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel. I'll return to Maggie, please, to finish your line of questioning.
Thanks very much, Kirkab. Just on dispersal, very, very quickly, John, when you talk about, you know, selecting dispersal accommodation, and I get the point you make about availability, but there's recently been a traumatised family who was placed in a boarded up block of flats on the edge of a derelict and abandoned estate in Port Glasgow. How on earth was that allowed to happen? you know, if there's nobody else in the block or only one or two other residents in the block, how is that deemed an appropriate place to put a traumatised family?
That clearly wasn't right, and it's probably part of the process of learning around why dispersal. So there was a process of talking to the local authority, getting approval for that property, but this is a new process for them as well. Many of the local authorities don't have the resource in place to help work with us to make sure that we are taking properties in the right place. And that's in Port Glasgow, I believe, the property you're referring to. That clearly wasn't appropriate, and therefore we moved the family and we've no longer managed that property. It was clearly inappropriate, and therefore we learn and we got rid of it. So as we go to wide dispersal, we need to learn from those instances to make sure there are more checks on, have we got the right area? We know Glasgow incredibly well. Glasgow are very well resourced to work with us and advise us on what is appropriate. We're learning with all the local authorities that we're now working with how to make sure that we get this right. If we get it wrong, we'll put it right and we'll end that. That's an absolute commitment.
Okay, thanks. And for you, Caroline, thank you for waiting. I'm just curious if you could say a little bit more about how you feel the access to provide the support you provide. Do you feel that you have the facilities, you have the access that you would want to have to be able to engage with the individuals and communities in hotels to provide the support you spoke of earlier? What are the challenges you find in engaging with those in hotel accommodation?
Thank you. It's a lot more complex than it used to be. We used to have clients based in the Glasgow area and they could come into our offices and see our staff face to face. I have 432 employees and our subcontractors have another 250 more, and there's 400 hotels around the UK. So we can't be everywhere, but when a new hotel is set up, we tend to send a team in and work with near staff on site to ensure those communication channels. We give posters and booklets in translated form so clients know who to contact. We run a 24/7 telephone line with interpretation. We do around 20,000 hours of interpretation, around 5,000 in Scotland alone, over telephone and face-to-face. So there is good access to language support in that work. We provided last month 2,000 devices for communication across the UK. That was 1,500 SIM cards, as well as some telephones, laptops and tablets to try and make access better. But it's incredibly difficult. And it's really difficult reaching people in the hotels. We work with near staff in hotels to set up appointments with clients, and our staff make attempts to contact people, but they don't want to be necessarily sitting in the hotel and waiting. They'll share phones among them because not everyone has a phone or have lost their phone on their journeys to the UK. So it is very effortful to make contact with people in hotels. Ideally, we would again be in a situation where people would pass through Glasgow initially, where staff and support services are concentrated and then could be dispersed in the wider dispersal after they've had that initial contact, because they'd be familiar working with us and working with the other charities in the sector. That would be the best of both worlds. It worked incredibly well in Scotland, probably the best I've seen in the UK, with people in flats having the independence to buy what they needed, care for themselves, make contact and support. But we recognise the population is so huge at the moment, that's not practicable.
Okay, thank you. And I suppose you because of the difficulties you raise, you would have concerns with hotel accommodation being used extensively and for the time periods people are in hotels becoming longer and longer because of the lack of dispersal accommodation or because of the time it takes to process all of that. Are there things that you think we collectively could be doing better to get people out of hotels more quickly? What would be your sort of silver bullet if you had one? What would it be?
It's twofold. So it's quicker decision making, which I know the Home Office is employing more and more decision makers to help. because the system is slowed down by the decision maker, but also affordable housing, because when people receive a decision, if it's a positive decision, they need to potentially move on to UK benefits or move into employment, and they'll need affordable housing. And between asylum support, homelessness support, the Ukrainian scheme, the Afghan scheme, the rental market is incredibly tight at the moment. So there needs to be solutions around accommodation that people can afford. And that's a UK-wide problem. I know in earlier sessions, people talked about modular buildings and solutions around that. And I know one of the people who gave evidence earlier said that's fine as long as it's not a camp of asylum seekers in modular buildings, that people are in communities. So I think that sort of support for asylum seekers is really important as long as that community embedding is still going on.
Okay. Thank you, Caroline. I'll leave it there, Kirkheb.
Thank you. Thanks, Maggie. Move on to my colleague, Pam.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, Caroline and John, and thank you for your opening statements. In the committee papers this week, it states that Mayors has an obligation to keep an attendance record of the people in initial accommodation every day. What sort of data do you collect and record, and how is that data used? And do you think that better information sharing between yourself and, say, the Home Office and local authorities would be helpful? And that's a question to John.
Okay. Yes, we keep a attendance log because it's important we know who's in the building for safety purposes and safeguarding. We record on our central system, which is a very secure IT system, who's allocated to which bedroom, and therefore we need to be able to report back to the Home Office that at the end of every week on their day that the people that they place there are still there and they're well and receiving the support that is being paid for. It's not, the hotels are free access, people can come and go. If they want to be away for a night or two to visit people, that's absolutely fine, just let us know, and that's recorded. So it's more a matter of safeguarding, because some people do disappear, and therefore we need to make sure that room is reused someone else. And we are alive to the risk of trafficking as well. So again, it's another safeguard to make sure that we're aware that people are where they should be and are getting support they needed. So the Home Office have that data. They know where everyone's housed. And we, in our regular calls to local authorities, will update them on how many people are in the hotels, where they've all got access to GP services. We share what data we can in terms of GDPR, and so the local authorities should be aware of how many people we house at any one time in the hotels.
Thank you, John. I'm going to come back to about vulnerable people and traffickers a little bit later on. But just on the question around the work you do with COSLA and local authorities, we had them obviously on last week, and they did say that they had a great working relationship with you. However, the third sector, who deliver a lot of the key services for asylum seekers, rely the asylum seekers rely on and have raised lots of concerns. Would you say that a good working relationship has to be there for the third sector with you? And how do you feel that it should be improved?
I think we do have a good relationship with many of the third sector organisations. So I'll share with the committee a summary of all the projects that we run with the hotel residents over and above the normal accommodation service to try and bring third sector in to give them support. We're very close with Tara, for example, and a lot of local charities that provide additional support, whether it's to mothers on their own, whether it's to vulnerable people. So I think we do have an incredibly rich network of contacts with third sector organisations, and also local football clubs run regular football sessions for the young men in the hotels and women who need exercise. So we reach out to a vast array of people to try and have that network. There's no organisation we won't talk to see if we can bring that assistance in. It's making sure that the support we provide is safe, is well managed, and is productive to make sure that people's time in the hotels are as comfortable and as good as it possibly can be, given the shortcomings of living in a hotel.
I mean, John, you thank you for that. You mentioned earlier on that you signpost So it's yourself that basically works with the third sector to bring that third sector in that is needed for that asylum seeker, is that right?
Yes, we try to, yes.
Okay. Just on trafficking now, we heard from previous witnesses over the weeks that hotels are typically targeted by traffickers to exploit vulnerable individuals in that accommodation. It was great to hear from Tara and Police Scotland about the work being undertaken to safeguard asylum seekers and refugees. How has your working relationship with Tara and Migrant Help changed your operation in order to help protect individuals potentially vulnerable to traffickers?
Obviously, safeguarding is at the heart of what we do. We recognise that people coming into the system, that people come to hotels and you arrive in the country, so it's a disorienting time. So we work very closely with Migrant Help and other bodies to make sure we get that induction right and make people aware of who they can come to for help if they're concerned, if they've got issues or they're worried, they know who to talk to, whether it's Migrant Help or whether it's a welfare officer. We work very, very closely with the local police who will come on site and talk to people about concerns. And our working relationship, I think Tara, past committees have said that we work very well with Tara to make sure that their information, their services are available. So it's something we're all alive to. I think in Scotland, it's something that's been well managed in terms of protecting people. It is a priority for us, and I do think that the relationships and the systems we have in place with those statutory and voluntary organisations have proved to be very strong. But no one's going to be complacent about it because it's clearly a massive risk and a concern to everybody.
John. Caroline, do you have anything to say on that?
Yes, we work with Tara and Police Scotland to provide support to victims, potential victims. We meet to discuss operational matters relating to people who are entering our services and specific cases. We talk to people about people within the trafficking service who may be moving and who are aware of risks. We take reports both through our office in Glasgow or on the telephone line if there's concerns about people in the hotels who may be traffickers, and we'll report that to the police if necessary, to the Home Office, to MERS, to flag any risk people. It's worth noting when there is initial asylum accommodation, there's a risk there equally to hotels, so that risk has always been present in the system. And it's really important that the accommodation providers have good staff alert to that, who can flag the risks, who can see if there are people hanging around outside the hotels who are presenting the risks. But the eyes on the ground make the biggest difference, and the asylum seekers that we support are often the first chance you get to hear something, so we're really quick to flag that up.
Just on that, Caroline, is there anything that you feel MERS could improve so that basically they can protect those vulnerable people from traffickers?
I think it's one of the things MERS ourselves, the Home Office, the whole sector really needs to work on and is concerned on working on, is to flag the risk. I know when Ukrainians came to the UK, we worked with Unseen, put out text messages to people's phones who came from the Ukraine saying this is the risk of traffickers. When you arrive at the airport, watch out for this. So as a nation, as a community, we want to support asylum seekers to say this is what trafficking looks like. We have a translation subsidiary, and I became aware there's not even a word for trafficking in some languages. So knowledge of the people who are at the greatest risk is where we'll make a difference.
Sure, I've just got one more question on religious settings, so if that's okay. John, I wanted to ask a question around earlier on you mentioned that sometimes you will have to go out the city centres into rural areas. What we heard from one of the evidence we took was that people like to, when they're in a foreign country, but the place that they feel home is the religious settings when it comes down to mosques, gurdwaras, you know, whether it's synagogues, anywhere, you know, that churches people feel that comfort with. Now, we know that in a lot of rural areas that there aren't a lot of places of community like that. So is that something that you have taken into account when moving people around? And obviously the data you collect, that the background these people are from, what they actually require when it comes down to community settings and houses of prayer?
So one of the things when we look at a hotel that's offered to us or we've identified is its setting. So we do try and avoid rural settings completely. Some are in on the edge of town, which is a bit more challenging. We do look at where there are places of worship, and if we establish a hotel, we talk to those places of worship to enable our residents to either go to that place of worship or for the place of worship to come to them. So we work very closely with local mosques in particular. So during periods of like Eid or Ramadan, we do a lot of work to make sure that our residents can observe correctly and get the support they need from the mosques. So that network with faith groups is really important and is established when we do open up a hotel. It is always difficult to do, but it is absolutely one of the priorities because, as you say, if you're new into a country and you're not able to access your faith, then that is completely disorientating and leaves people feeling vulnerable and very cut off. So it is important to us, and it is an important thing we do in interact with those faith groups. So yes, I'd say that's one of the priorities when we establish a hotel to make sure that works.
Just on that, John, is it a tailored service or is it just when people come you just provide that induction saying that there's mosques here, there's gurdwaras here, there's churches here, or do you actually state and identify somebody from the Muslim background and say that this is your faith, that this is what's available here and this is what's your, you know, what's available there? So is that individual or is it a group settings? You just put that out there?
It's a bit of both, I think. It depends on the size of the hotel. It depends on what's available, what's nearby, you know, how close the nearest mosque are, how that mosque is interacting with us. And most of them interact really positively and reach out to create those networks. And if there's a need for transport, we'll help establish transport and so forth to make sure people can access those services. So it's a bit of both, if you like. I don't think there's a one size fits all. Equally, we don't know who's going to be placed in each hotel. So the faiths will change and therefore we need to adapt, as you say, to the cohort of people that live in that hotel to make sure that we adjust as that cohort changes over time, because it does change and we need to make sure, and one of the key things is to make sure we get the food menu right and that the food menu respects people's requirements on a faith basis.
Just on going back to the trafficking, obviously we found that through the evidence that certain individuals and women may not always go to the police, but they will trust third sector sometimes to go there first. And the police identified that as well. And it may be because the countries these women come from, the police has a different sort of system, which I won't say what kind of system, but maybe it's not so trustworthy for those women. And when they come here, they're a bit scared to go to the police. So do you find, John, that those women do come to mayors as well for that help sometimes before they go to the police?
100%. There is often, quite rightly, a fear of authority. People in uniform can be very intimidating based on the person's past experience and why they've come to this country for sanctuary. So yes, our welfare officers do a huge amount of work around that first point of contact. So the welfare officer on site will be that first point of contact, whether it's they will also contact migrant help if migrant help are on site or by the phone line. But I think our welfare officers do a lot. I was with welfare officers in Glasgow last week and talking about the impact it has on them. They hear some very disturbing stories about what's happened to someone in their country of origin and some of their experiences. So it's something that is quite traumatic for our staff, which we need to support them with, but they're very aware of those pressures and the need to make sure that the people who are coming to them get the support they need and access the services they need through the police in a way they find that is supportive and not intimidating.
Thank you, John. Caroline, is there anything you want to add before we wrap up and pass it back to the chair?
Yeah, happy to add. We speak to every asylum seeker when they enter the system, when they complete the asylum support form, and that is a question we ask of them. And we ask about their experience and we try and help explain what trafficking is. Both men and women are given the opportunity and we're a first responder across the UK because we recognise that people don't always go to the police and then they feel uncomfortable. So they can enter the NRM, we'll support them in their application to enter the NRM. So we work very closely with Police Scotland to give people the opportunity to tell their story. And it's one of the key concerns around the Nationality and Borders Bill is the need under the bill for people to declare that they are a victim of trafficking early when it's such a frightening thing to admit to. So we take a really trauma-informed approach and try and help people disclose any trafficking in their history.
Thank you, Caroline. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I would like to talk about children within the system. And so far, we've heard a lot of evidence from in previous sessions regarding the experiences of children. I want to kick off talking about unaccompanied children first and foremost. So, Caroline, could you just give us a quick sort of overview of how unaccompanied children, what is their sort of experience of the system as we present it here?
Within Scotland, we tend to deal with unaccompanied children who have been assessed as adults, and they are dispersed into accommodation as an adult. We support adult asylum seekers and their families, but either we are concerned that someone looks like a child, or they self-identify as being under 18. So we employ through our own resources an age dispute advisor to work with that young person, and our staff are trained in this, where we will refer them to the local authorities, to social services, we'll explain the system for disputing their age, we'll advise the accommodation provider so they can make them safe within the accommodation and move them to a location where they're not housed with adults. And we also give them signposting and support in getting legal advice, and we follow up on it because we know it's a lot for a young person to cope with, to make sure that they're getting legal advice to change the status within the system. Our services don't support people who are placed as unaccompanied minors, and that's a contract that Refugee Council holds with the Home Office.
Okay. We've had reference being made to the Scottish Government's pilot into independent child trafficking guardians. And the aim of that was to tackle child trafficking, anyone under 18 suspected of being a victim or unaccompanied asylum-seeking children will be given a guardian. Can you give us a view on that? What's your experience of that?
We don't cross into that work at all, but we really support the pilot and the need for that because there is a great risk. And we know a huge number of young people are coming across the channel in small boats. And so the traffickers are taking advantage of that.
Thank you for that. John, could I turn to you? In your opening statement, you mentioned that you were supporting 16 schools. What is the nature of that support?
A facilities management service. So we provide the facilities management to those schools. So we do the cleaning, the caretaking, the mechanical engineering system. So it's not support in terms of pupils, it's our facilities management company. We make sure those schools are fit, safe places to learn.
Oh, right.
So there's extent of the services MIAS has across Scotland.
Oh, right. So it's not specifically for...
It's not asylum seekers, no. It's to do with... I was trying to explain the breadth of the services that MIAS has in Scotland.
Right, right. OK, thank you. I'm glad that we've got that cleared up there. So I'm sort of like... you've talked and mentioned a little bit about the mother and baby unit that was used by MIAS in Glasgow and the lessons that were learned there. But very recently in the press, there's another hotel that's been used, and I think that there's about 10 rooms there that are being used for mothers and mothers-to-be, I suppose. I won't name the hotel, but I am aware of it, and I know that the... size of it is actually quite limiting, and there are no kitchen facilities for mothers to sort of, I suppose, have some kind of autonomy over there. So can you give us a little bit of insight into why that particular hotel was chosen? And I do bear in mind that you have already said that it's not ideal to have mother and babies in hotels.
No, I mean, the mother and baby unit in Glasgow was had its own kitchen. They had their own kitchen, so they were create their own food. Unfortunately, there are a small number of mothers and babies in the hotels, and that's purely, as I say, down to supply. So we had to find capacity so that when a mother and baby arrived in the country, we could make sure they had a room to live in. They are prioritised with the Home Office to move on to dispersed accommodation as soon as possible. We do make sure that they have access to food, powdered milk, and baby equipment, nappies, and everything else they need whilst they're in a hotel. And the hotel is charged with making sure that the food is appropriate for a nursing mother as well. So, as I say, it's far from ideal. We try and minimise the time. that hotel, it was deemed that it was probably the one that was available at the time, where we could meet the housing need, because those people needed somewhere to live. So yes, it's not ideal. I'd much rather we didn't have children in the hotels, but for the short period of time they do need to be, we try and make it as comfortable and designed as possible to make the life easier for them.
But you do get the fact that a hotel room with, say, a double bed in it is not necessarily going to have space for a crib in there, and also all the equipment that a newborn baby would require. Plus, it's a very vulnerable time for mothers, for any mother, but a mother that's fleeing from trauma and the additional support services that are required. What availability is there of all the sort of like health and social care, I suppose, services that mother and child will need?
Yeah, it's far from ideal. We make sure that the room can take a cot and we can give them the equipment they need. Space is limited, and as you quite rightly say, it isn't where a young child and a young mother should be. Absolutely, it shouldn't be. All we can do is try and move them on as quickly as we possibly can. We do work very closely with health and social care partnerships in all the local authorities to make sure that those mothers have a GP service, that the asylum health bridging team, who are excellent, have access and provide access to those mothers on a daily basis. I can't speak high enough of the bridging teams that provide that service to the mothers in our hotels. The priority for us is to make sure that they stay in the hotel for the very least possible time, if at all, and that we get them out into dispersed accommodation where they have their own space and their own home.
And regarding sort of like slightly older children, I suppose, I'm particularly thinking about primary school age children, but actually all the way through the system, children need to be with other children. So what sort of facilities or provisions do you put in place so that people and children in particular can be connected to each other, i.e. playrooms, and have access to toys and books?
The hotel has sufficient space. As I said, we try and make sure when we take a hotel and it does have communal areas where we can create playrooms, and we do work with voluntary organisations to make sure, as you say, toys, play space, books are available in various languages. And we do work closely with the education authorities to make sure they have access to a school place, because if they're going to be there for some time, they do access school, and that if we are then moving into dispersed accommodation, we'll try and make sure that we minimise any move from a school to another school. So that's one of the key things. Certainly down in North East Yorkshire Humber area, we do try and make sure that school places are maintained and we disperse in the same catchment area so that there's as least disruption to a child's education as possible. It's a far from ideal situation, but it is about trying to, as we try to say, do the best we can to provide the environment that a child needs. And being in a hotel clearly isn't that. We work with Glasgow City Council and learn from how they operate their homelessness, about how they support children in the homelessness system and the systems that are there for education, health and social services, to make sure we have best practice to look after the well-being of a young child. It's, as you say, is growing and developing.
Yeah. I thank you for your answers. Sort of evidence that I've taken, and it's anecdotal, it's through chats, but it's people's lived experience, so it is entirely valid, is that when there are tensions in the system and things aren't working, you've given us a good outline of what you technically provide, and I'm sure that you do. But when things go wrong, what I'm hearing is that very vulnerable people have to rely on third sector organisations or advocates to sort of defend their case and fight their corner. And a common phrase I've heard is that mirrors do get there in the end, but you have to fight for it. And in my head, I'm just thinking, you're clearly very experienced at this. You know, you run lots of outlets, you do lots of things. So why is it that people are still thinking? Why are you not getting it right the first time, if you know what I mean? I'm sure that's what you would want to do. So why is that maybe not happening?
Of course it's what we want to do, and I would suggest that we do get it right first time the majority of times. There's always, and the scale of what we're operating, the speed of how it's operating, there will be times when we get it wrong. I do believe we try and rectify those problems as quickly as we can, and I completely understand from the other position where an NGO or an advocating organisation would feel that it's a system there, banging their heads against the wall, waiting for us to respond. I believe we do respond. We have to go through a process. We work closely with Migrant Help because they are there to take those issues on board from the service user. And then we go to the Home Office to say, you know, either we need to move somebody or what we have to do, or if it's just for us to solve a problem, I hope we do solve that problem as soon as we possibly can within the confines. I was just looking, we have at the moment in the hotel population, the vast majority of the service users, 492 out of 585 are single males. We've got 10 single males in the hotels and there's 83 family cases. We try and keep families right down to a minimum because it's absolutely the case and they do flow through. I do believe we learn. I do believe we put problems right as soon as we possibly can. But I do completely understand why from the outside some NGOs and voluntary groups will think it's a frustrating system and they wonder why it takes us 2 or 3 days to respond when they think it should be that day. And maybe it should be, and we are trying to make sure we're responsive to those needs. So, you know, I'd always take on board any cases you want to send through to me personally, and I'd advocate for them, because I'm personally responsible for these contracts. Across the three contract areas, the three countries, we're currently looking after 30,000 people. So the welfare of 30,000 people means a lot, and anything that happens that isn't right is something that we want to confront and deal with. So it's always preferable for me that someone in your position comes to me with a case and says, I've heard this person is struggling, why? And I'll give you chapter and verse. You know, we'll make sure that you understand the issues and what we've tried to do. And, you know, we will put our hands up and say, yeah, we could have done that quicker, and we'll find out why that happened and put it right. But on the whole, you know, I'm close enough to the system and the staff to know that we approach it with the best possible intentions to, as I said earlier, to centre the service user, the resident, at the heart of what we do. There's no point looking after 30,000 other people.
I think my colleague Ben McPherson would like to come in.
A general point, convener. I don't know if this is the right juncture to come in. If you're content, it's related.
I am content for you to.
Thank you, convener. Just with regard to the evidence given thus far. And I note the point from my colleague, Mr. O'Kane, about immigration law being a reserved matter. But all of the evidence I've seen for several years is that migrants make a net contribution, not just socially to the wider benefit, but economically. And the areas in which asylum seekers are placed in Scotland, most of the areas in which that's taking place are currently experiencing labour shortages. And where you can give comment, and I appreciate that Carolyn O'Connor may be able to say more than yourself, John Taylor, but I'd be really interested in any reflections about how much benefit it would bring if we had a sensible approach that allowed asylum seekers to work and participate in the economy in order to begin that net contribution at an earlier stage, have resource, build skills, be able to assist themselves more in achieving housing and contributing to society as much as they end up doing if they're successful through the asylum system, so to speak.
Thank you. Yes, as you say, it is difficult. I'm obviously here representing MIRS, and we're a service provider. We're not a political organisation or a campaigner, so I would rather not comment on policy. What I would comment on is that although we've talked a lot about the vulnerability of a lot of the people we look after, we do know that most of the people, if not all the people we accommodate, want to be involved in the community. They want to have jobs. They want to produce something. They've come here for a reason. And anything we can do to support them, become part of the community, we will do. And I reckon, as you say, if you look over a migration over the last 500 years, you'd say that the country is a richer place in many ways for migration. So I don't want to comment politically, but I recognise the rich background of the people that we do accommodate. Some are very professional, skilled people, but they're going through the system, and hopefully when they get a positive decision, they'll go on to make a productive contribution to society.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Carolyn O'Connor.
Yes, thank you, and thank you for raising it. Employability is an issue really close to our heart at Migrant Help, and we're funding this year around £200,000 towards projects to help people access employability. It helps community cohesion. It helps people appreciate the benefit that asylum seekers bring into the system. We have labour shortages, as you say, not only in Scotland, but across the UK, and a group of people who desperately want to work. We typically see young men. The majority of asylum seekers are young men who become institutionalized sitting in hotels or in asylum accommodation, unable to work, unable to access enough ESOL lessons, unable to put their skills to use. And if given the chance, the contribution they could make would be much more effective, much quicker into the system, and the cost of the asylum system could be driven down because people are waiting until they have a decision and move on to benefits before they have the opportunity to find work. So it would release pressure across the system if that opportunity was there.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, you're happy with that? I'll just come back in. Caroline, I just wanted to ask you again about the children's situation. So did you get a chance to, I don't think you did get a chance to respond to when there are tensions within the system and things haven't worked out well. How well do you think at the moment things are resolved? Are they listened to empathetically? How quick? And what could be done to support either yourselves or Mears? You know, what? Because obviously we will be making recommendations coming out from this inquiry. So how can things be improved?
One of the issues are the tensions from the volumes. So releasing the volumes in the system by quicker decision making, by accommodation, by helping people move on and start their lives will make a big difference. When we tendered for this contract 4 years ago, it was at around a third of the volumes that we currently seek into the system. So systems across the charity sector are stretched at breaking point, and COVID decimated some of the charities and some of their funds and their ability to work. So more funding directed towards third sector groups that help people, particularly after they've completed the asylum journey. So either those with no recourse to public funds or those who have just received a decision will make a big difference to help the pressures on the system. Engaging people in the communities, so putting them into properties as soon as possible rather than hotels, and so they can then stay in the communities once they've received decisions, will help tremendously. And it's all the things around the New Scots strategy that is more important than ever in the situation that we're facing that will make a real difference to the services. This group has talked about interpretation and the access of language resource and ESOL to people who are entering the asylum system and spending 2 years looking for something to do. Funding towards ESOL from the Scottish Government would be really welcome, and it'll help employability, it'll help access to services. So I think continuing to push that Scottish strategy forward, seeing what the central government is willing to fund or can push to help solve some of these problems also make a big difference. And I recognise that asylum seekers are coming to Scotland because they feel the services and the support here are better. So it's taking those lessons back to the central UK government and say, this is what's working, this is what people are coming to seek to find, would be fantastic.
Thank you. Thanks, Caroline. Can I bring my colleague Fulton in, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Firstly, can I offer my apologies for spending most of the meeting so far on remote, so have been online. The reason for that was there was significant delays on the Airdrie Bathgate line today, which is my train line, which I'm sure will be reported on given the extent of them. I've got a few questions, convener. I hope you'll take some sympathy on with my travel woes, and I can ask them. Would that be all right?
I can give you a little bit of leeway, Fulton.
Thank you. I really appreciate that, convener. First question is for yourself, John. I would like to caveat an apology if as I say, I was on remote, but if I missed anything and it's been answered, then please just say in the interest of time. But, John, I wanted to ask, I know that mayors have been looking at forming a housing association. Mm. Are you able to update on any progress or otherwise around that and how that might impact the work you do with asylum seekers?
Yeah, that's something that's very important to us. As I said in my opening remarks, in England we have a housing association registered provider, and we provide 3,500 homes for homeless families for local authorities. And what we're very keen to do is have a housing association in Scotland where we could work with local authorities to provide move-on accommodation for asylum seekers to get a positive decision, because we are acutely aware that that's going to become a massive problem for local authorities. Part of wire dispersal is where do the positive decisions make. Certainly Glasgow have a huge challenge. We've been working with the Scottish Housing Regulator for the last 5 years to see if we can register, showing the extent of our services, not just homelessness, but around special needs housing and elderly housing. And we've shown them the models we work in England, which are viable and successful. The feedback we've got this year is that the regulator has concerns about registering a housing association that ultimate parent is a private company. So the housing association would be, if it was registered, a charity. It would be a standalone limited company. It would be linked to our English Housing Association, which is a not-for-profit body that is owned by MERS. If we could get registered, then we've been talking with Glasgow about operating a scheme to acquire hundreds of properties for homeless households to alleviate pressure directly for asylum seekers that get the positive decision, so they can stay in Glasgow, they can go into employment, children stay in their schools. So we have the funding to be able to buy those properties and secure those properties. We would love to be able to do it, but I think we do need that RP status, RSL status in Scotland. At the moment, the regulator's not minded to register us. I'm looking to see if we can do similar type of funding without that RSL status. It is harder, because I think giving a homeless family an RSL tenancy is actually quite powerful, because it gives them security after years in the asylum system of insecurity. I think to be able to have a secure tenancy and know that they can settle without that uncertainty they've been living under would be brilliant. So we have been and are committed to setting up RSL, but we will be the first of its kind in Scotland, so clearly there's some challenges there, but it's something we'd really like to do.
Okay, thanks very much for that update on it, because I know from your presence that you have in North Lanarkshire, from my own constituency, is that, that is something that you've been working on for a period of time. And I'm sorry if my line of questioning is a bit disjointed and maybe doesn't join up exactly, but I'll bear with me. And probably for yourself, Caroline, and John, but I'm interested, it's something that's come up in the various committee sessions that we've had on this, is around about interpreters. What's your thoughts on that? What is the service provision like around interpreters? Is there difficulties with it, and how do you think we might overcome that? Because we've heard quite a lot of panellists tell us that there's real concerns in this area.
We're very lucky in that we don't have any issues with interpreters. We have a subsidiary company that provides interpretation and translation for migrant help on our telephone lines and for every meeting with a client where it's required. And we get an interpreter on the line within 2 minutes, 90% of the time. Even with difficult languages, we have processes in place to work with other agencies. And we have good information about the languages clients speak. So there is really good resourcing around the interpretation. We've provided translation for some other organisations, and our subsidiary has a project called Empower that trains interpreters, and we try and identify people who've gotten status that may want to work as interpreters, and we fund the training for them with no come back. They're not required to come work for us. So we're trying to help populate those more difficult languages with interpreters. What is important is that other agencies have access to interpreters as well. So our subsidiary provides small grants for small charities to be able to get interpreters. But it's really important that the government has those facilities in place. I know NHS does. I know our subcontractors do. So when people get move-on support, they have that there. We work with NERS and the other accommodation providers
to translate their information, and people call our helpline when they get a letter in English that they don't understand, and we'll get an interpreter on to read it to them. So I think it's really important that people understand where they can get interpreters, what their rights are, and that organisations that don't have it yet look to put it into place.
Thanks very much. John, have you got anything to add to that? How do your team access interpreters? Is there any difficulties with that, or do you feel you've got support?
Not particularly. We, as Karen says, we have all our information translated into the 12 most common languages that covers just about everybody in our system. So the induction packs, information packs, etc. They obviously have all the information to the AIR contract that Karen runs, which is where the issues and reporting goes. All our staff have an app on their tablets that links straight into Language Line, which means that they, when they're in a property or in a, wherever they are with us, one of our residents, they can immediately access Language Line and get an interpreter there and then, so they can have a three-way conversation. So, and that's available in the hotels, so we can always access an interpreter. We do use local interpreters as well, so if we need someone on site, we can arrange for them to be on site as well. So it's not one of the biggest problems we've got. It's the systems are in place.
Okay, thanks for that. And one final question, if that's okay, convener.
A very small question, very succinct answers.
Yeah, and it is. It's one that's probably... And it might have been answered, and if it has, just please say, given what the convener said there. But it's something that's came across my mind as we've been taking these sessions, probably for yourself, John, but maybe Caroline as well, whoever. It's in relation to if you've got asylum seekers coming from different countries, say, or different regions, how is that managed? Are Mears and other organisations aware of any difficulties that might be around that, and how is that managed? It's a very sort of general question.
There's probably people from multiple countries. There's probably 12 countries in total that where the vast majority of our asylum seekers come from. So we do, after 4 years running the contract, have a good experience of understanding where people have come from and some of the issues they've been fleeing. And obviously that's where our translation services are aimed at. So it is important that we get that right in terms of, in a hotel setting, that there's integration occasion, that we make sure that various nationalities can live together well. It's really just part of the process, really, and the hotels are more of a challenge, but dispersed accommodation, it's understanding what people's social needs are and they have access to. There's a lot of, especially in Glasgow, there's a lot of groups that are set up to deal and support with the Afghans or the Somalis or Eritreans, and the Afghan United group in Scotland, in Glasgow in particular, are fantastic in reaching out and helping us work with those communities, and Afghan United do some superb work with us.
Excellent. Caroline, if you get anything to add to that?
It's only worth adding that we will take reports through our telephone line if there are any racial tensions, any concerns in any of the accommodation or hotels between different groups, and we'll escalate that to the Home Office, to Mears, and we will also escalate it to the police if there's a real risk of any troubles starting because of that, because we do recognise sometimes different factions from the same country will come and end up being placed together, so we're very alert to those risks.
Thank you for that. Just before we conclude our formal business, members have indicated a few other lines of questioning. Are our contributors this morning content for us to write to you with any further questions? Thank you. Thank you for that.
If anyone would like to come and visit any of our hotels or buildings, absolutely happy to accommodate that.
Thank you. So that does conclude our formal business this morning, and I thank our witnesses for attending today. We will now move into private to consider the remaining item on our agenda.